you for the invitation here. I'm really, really happy to be able to present my work here. I try to describe a bit from where I'm coming. I mean, the sources of my inspiration and also my scientific cursus. And yeah, I will describe that, and also I will describe a bit more about my processes for creating and what could still be inspiring for me. And also I will present some specific selected works. So as she said, if you have some questions or if you want to discuss about something, we can do that during the lecture. I mean, I'd like it to be like a discussion, or if you prefer to do that later, I mean, in the end, we can do that too. So I would like to start about my studies. I'm more coming from a scientific field and not really art field. And I started with by studying biology and biophysics stuff. I was interested by the different living and protein structures. So it is named like structures of macromolecules. So I was like amazed at this moment by what the matter could become. And what, how it could be organized, and like, yeah, I think this is also why I'm now interested by architecture, because it is a way of like populating the space. You know, macromolecules were really tiny, and architecture is more at the human level. You know, so I have studied computer science at this moment. I was interested by how we could use these tools for discovering new things, how we could use these tools for representing the world. And all along this path, I was making music and I was creating new sounds. But it was like not yet assumed as something I wanted to publish. So it was like a bit confidential and only personal stuff. And progressively, during all my studies, I also knew, as a lot of you, the computer's powers increasing, and progressively we were able to create sounds and process sounds directly with a small computer like that. So progressively, I have been interested in creating new stuff by using only algorithms. So this is a very important part of my work, because at the beginning I was only wanted to create sounds only by using the computer. So I wasn't recording any sound from the outside. It sounds a bit crazy maybe, because I have a lot of friends, artists, and that started by recording sound outside. And they were like a bit frightened by my approach, which was only like, I don't know the word in English, intrinsic in French. Everything was coming only from inside the computer, not outside, okay? So, intrinsical? Okay.
I don't know the word in English.
Yeah, I think this is that word.
Intrinsic.
Okay, thank you. It is a bit the same word. So, I was really interested by creating things only from scratch. So you don't have anything at the beginning, you have the blank page, and progressively you started to create some kind of rules, and a signal can occur, it can appear, and we can hear that signal. So I had a kind of engineer approach to this kind of creation. So at the beginning I didn't design any kind of installation. It was only music and only for live performance. So I was doing that with some friends. It was very, very personal and confidential. So I think I wasn't mature enough for assuming that. But All these years were very important. I understood that later, but all these years were very important for me because I learned a lot of tools and I explored a lot of different techniques. Some were really complex, and I think that like formatted all my further years until now. On this view, I'm just explaining that I'm doing autonomous installations, which are like exhibition you can visit and experience. I'm also doing live performances, and these two different axes are for me two very, very different ways. In autonomous installation, I will talk about that later, it is like creating a system that can be autonomous, and all these systems are absolutely not interactive. So this is a special form of expression for me. It is like creating a system that can represent someone else. This is not exactly me. It is a part of me living by itself, and I let it go. I will talk about that a bit later in the presentation. Live performance is like creating a system I can control. So for me, this is very different because I can alter the way the system is working and generating things. So these two axes are very important in my work. And basically, I started to release some tracks, and I'm composing a lot, very often using this kind of algorithms too. We'll talk about that. And I have also two other components in my work which are really, really important, which are teaching, because transmitting different knowledge in different conditions, like sometimes in art school or design school, also in university, every time related to the relationship between art and science, how we can use science for creating art. And scientific are interested also by the opposite approach, how we can use art for maybe solve some scientific specific problems. And creation is quite new for me, but I think it is very important as an artist to also try to collect and to manage how we can show the art of other people, other artists, sometimes friends, but also very different artists. So this is the very new component for me, but it's very important. So as I was explaining at the beginning, the sound was the very first matter I started to create and started to alter. So at the beginning, there was only the synthesis for me. So I had nothing, and I wanted to create and to control each different samples of my digital signal, for instance. So it was very important for me at this moment because I was interested in, I think, in that part of my life, in controlling a lot, not letting things going by themselves. And this is why I was created sound from scratch. At this moment, I was only using hardware, and progressively I discovered some software with the power of computer increasing, like software like MaxMSP environment. I don't know if some of you know about that, but basically this is a programming environment. So you start with a blank page and you start to build some kind of code. This is not called code, but this is our object we can connect. And basically you are creating a program like a programmer. So you are creating a specific object that can trigger sounds. You can create some object that can respond to a specific trigger for generating sounds. And basically you can create some rules and some algorithm based program that can create sound and process sound, etc. So when I discover MaxMSP, it is about, I would say, like 20 years ago, a bit less maybe. It had triggered a lot of things in me because I had a kind of like a blank page I could just populate with specific objects, specific rules I could decide, and I started to let the computers running without controlling it. And for me, it was very interesting because I created some rules at the beginning, and basically the computer was giving me kind of responses, producing things. I wouldn't say producing things for me, but producing things for itself. And some part of these things could be interesting for me, but it was like living organisms, okay? It was like, maybe it was also related to my previous courses in biology. It was like creating a kind of living thing, okay? And at this moment, I started to play with MaxMSP. I learned a lot by myself because we couldn't find a lot of books about that. Now there are some books about that. And it was really interesting because I also participate to the evolution of the software progressively. And they added a lot of things for not only making and processing sounds, but also creating visuals and also connecting that to some physical computing parts like small circuits, electronic circuits. We could add some kind of sensors and actuators, so we could give to the computer a lot of sensors for like sensing the physical world, like the reality around it. And I have been interested in interactivity at this moment, but actually I'm not too much into that, except in my some of courses I am giving. But and progressively I added new things, and I started to open the computer to the world. And this is why what I called injecting field recording. Basically, I will talk about that a bit later, but it is like injecting elements from the physical world into my computer. It is quite new, and I think it has started because I had some personal things in my life that changed me, and I started to use a computer not only for like a closed system that could work only by itself, but also as something that could be open to the world. So it sounds a bit crazy because a lot of installation done with this kind of softwares are just using kind of microphone, listening the real sounds around the computer, but this is quite new for me because I think this is a very, very huge change since something like 2 years or 3 years, no more. But I will talk about this kind of reality injection in the computer a bit later. I also mentioned the Laboratoire de Mécanique et Acoustique, which is a research lab in Marseille, which is the place where I'm living. And for me, this is very important place there because this is a lab of professor named Jean-Claude Risset. Maybe you know about him. He was a very, very important pioneer of sound and computer sound, basically. Yeah, he had this double cursus in his life. He was like I don't know the word, maybe a PhD, doctoral field. I'm sorry, some words are missing in English for me. So he had two different ways of in his studies. He was he did the cursus of the conservatory, so he was like a composer, but also a guy who studies physics. And I was like really like fascinated by this double cursus because it was really hard in France, especially to have this kind of double cursus. You have to choose something. And at this moment, I also decided to choose myself to not to choose something. I wanted to be in both ways. So I mentioned this lab on this page because for me this is a place where I'm going every time. I'm helping them to just make some computer implementation of their theories related to sound and sound perception. I'm using MaxMSP with them. So basically, I'm working as a programmer for them, and they are helping me a lot with all my installations specifically. So they are like scaling my installations, power for the sound, and etc. So we have also a lot of discussion, and all these things are very inspiring for me. This is why I mentioned that here. I can give you some links later if you are interested, of course. So basically, visual forms came very later. I have been really interested in representing the sound and how a sound can be represented on the visual way. So I started to play with visual forms by using some my environment, programming environment like Processing and also MaxMSP, of course. And I called that generativity because I was doing exactly the same as I was doing with the sound, but with visual, I was creating rules, and these different rules were generating different elements on the screen. So I started with a blank page, and my different rules was like iterating process, and it started to draw on the screen. I will show you some examples later. And of course, I wanted to represent the sound, but I also wanted the sound to influence visuals. So this is what I called audio reactivity. So basically, I dived into visual because I wanted like the sound alter different visual matter. So this is a really important part of my work. Because it also gives a specific way. I don't use visual for altering the sound, but this is every time the sound altering visuals for me. And I have been really interested by different kind of structure and architecture. Basically, this is for me architecture is a way for like populating the space, creating different shapes in the space. You have an empty space, and at some point, you have to use some rules and to deal with some constraints for populating it and to create different shapes in that space. And basically, this is how I am working with my visual. And progressively, exactly as I did for the sound, I'm using kind of physical word injection in my visual. So at the beginning, everything was generated like by using algorithms and geometry. So basically, it was like only mathematical equations were creating things, nothing coming from the outside. And now, progressively, I started to use previously recorded matter. So if I go on the previous page, it is exactly the same. I was doing only synthesis at the beginning, nothing coming from the outside, and progressively I'm injecting the outside into my computer, and I'm doing that also with my visuals. So I will give you two examples at least related to two different projects later in the presentation. Okay. So this is what I described a bit. These are the processes I'm using in almost each of my projects. Basically, for me, the sound represents my very intimate and inner world. Why I'm saying that? This is just because I feel that the sound represents less, I could say it like that, less information than a picture, and I think this is more evocative than any pictures. So for me, this is not an axiom, but this is something I just noticed for me. And this is why I'm using the sound as a first source and as an influencer for the shape and for visuals. So I started to play with shapes because shapes is in a specific way representing my world outside. And the sound is me trying to change this world. I think this is something we can retrieve in different work I did. And as I said, progressively the system and the tools are like opening to themselves, to the world. So this is why what I mentioned as progressively injecting the outside into the inside. And I will describe that with two projects. The first project is Alpha and the second one is Fragments. This is the one I will play tomorrow at the museum. And I think we can just describe that. So Alpha is a live performance, and it is based on the system I built. And this system is just a visual system that can react and that can evolve and be altered by the sound. So on stage, I'm only playing with the sound part. So I'm deconstructing some different parts. So I'm changing the way they are triggered in time. Okay, so I'm playing with the time, but I'm also playing with the nature of the sound. So I'm filtering the sound. I'm changing the sound itself. And all these different alterations are also altering visuals. So visuals are generating in real time, so there is absolutely nothing coming from the outside and no video matter previously recorded. So it is like if the geometry was altering itself. I wrote that in there. And basically, this, without the algorithm, this project would be like a blank page, okay? So I have some algorithm generating lines, repeating lines like that on the screen. And depending on the sound and the sound changing, the lines are moving differently. So beyond this project, and there are a lot of sound analysis done in real time, because basically I have my visual system like just listening the sound I'm producing with another software. And the sound analysis is trying to extract in real time different parameters from the signal. And these parameters are, we can call that sound descriptors. Basically, the first one we can mention is like the volume. Like a perceived volume. So if the volume is very, very loud, we can imagine that, for instance, the lines are more dense. There are a lot of lines. And we can also imagine that we can use that on the opposite way. So if the sound is very low, we can have less line on the screen. And this first parameter is maybe the most usual one, because this is the volume and we can perceive a sound which is loud or not loud. But there are a lot of sound descriptors I'm using there, and thanks to the lab and the science behind it, I'm using some different descriptors. Like there is one which has a very weird name, it is named centroid. Basically, this is like a kind of mean of all frequencies of the spectrum. So sometimes when I have a filter which is like cutting the high frequency part of the spectrum, the centroid is low, so I can use that for maybe changing the visuals in a specific way. And during my live performance, I'm altering the sound only, and my system is reacting to what I'm doing. Okay, so I have a part I can absolutely control, which is the sound, except that sometimes I'm using some kind of random and like constrained chance part, but I'm controlling that, and the visual system is just listening to what I am doing. And it can also react a bit as it wants, because I have let it a lot of rooms for random in the system, okay? But of course, this is not like pure random, because I think as a creator, we have to like to let it go, but not in all possible territories. This is a part of the aesthetic choice. So in my studio, when I programmed this, I decided at this specific moment to react a bit like that, or a bit like that. And these choices have been done at some point. So rules are existing, but there are a lot of rooms for, like, yeah, for the system to do what it wants to do. Okay. So this project is only, I would say, only equations. Even for the sound, there is no previously recorded sound. So everything is just synthesized in real time. Okay. So this project is very important for me because it is like, how could I say that? It represents a specific moment of my life where when I wanted to, it is a bit frightening, but to control everything. So this project means that, yeah, everything is like control. If I don't want something on the screen is like dark, okay? So everything is like managed. And I didn't want to use previously stuff. So I didn't like inject the past, what I could call the past, in the present, in the moment of the performance. Everything was like doing in real time. Said like that, it is a bit frightening for me too, but anyway, I can assume that now. So these are just different picture from the Alpha Live performance. I can maybe try to show you that in live, if it works. Spectrum, but this is just for giving you some a concrete example of all this line changing depending on the sound triggered by the sound itself, and on stage I'm altering only the sound. Another example I could I will talk about another project which is not exactly the opposite but very different. Oops. Yeah, this project. This is the one I will play tomorrow. And basically, these two projects, there were some projects in between Alpha, which is like 4 years ago, and Fragments, which is 1 year ago. But these two elements are like two different poles of a specific axis. And in Fragments, this is also geometry, but altering, the world. Basically, I used, in this project, I used a lot of equations and algorithms, okay? But the very raw first matter is something that had been recorded before. For me, it was like very huge change, and I was basically, I didn't choose that myself. It was like natural, and it has come to me like very important. It was like recording something from the past, sorry, and using it on stage in the present moment. And when I started to record sound like that, I didn't know how much it will be important for me to use the same process for visual. And I started the project by creating specific lines, again, these lines. And at some point I stopped everything and I also delete everything on my computer related to the visual part because I wanted to inject some part of the world, and in that case, these portraits. And so I absolutely changed the way I wanted to work, and I worked with a friend, which is also a photographer, artist, and I wanted to have this different person portrayed like that, and I used that as a raw matter. So all equations are still existing and altering my stuff, but in that case, these are altering, I would say, a real matter, something more figurative, and we can't feel, I think, the same kind of process, like the sound altering visual matter, the sound create analysis, just processing visuals, but in that case, all matter have been pre-recorded before, I mean. Maybe I can show you some parts. So these are just pictures. And yeah, we can also feel that these lines, but they are like a result, like a consequence of these videos previously recorded. So yeah, maybe I can, yeah, this one is quite frightening. Like a strange ghost. Maybe I can show you some part of the live performance, because this project is both an installation and a live performance. Yeah. One is one of the six contexts in the live performance. Yeah. Yeah. At least if it doesn't work, maybe we give you the intention to come tomorrow. It is absolutely not intended, but it is nice. Case, you can see the same kind of process. So the sound is altering visuals, but visuals are like showing real people. There is, I think, a kind of weird thing, because these are real people, but in specific conditions. Every people have been shot in video, like all in the same conditions. So I think this is, again, this idea of controlling things appearing like that. But I have more like, I didn't want to use any kind of other video synthesis or stuff. So I'm only using this video that have been recorded. And for me, this is very challenging because I lose some kind of control because the matter is that one, and I can process that in life, but I have to deal with what has been recorded previously. And for me, it is like more assuming kind of past, you know. And dealing with that past and using the past and changing it in many ways, but maybe I cannot create something very, very, very different because I have to deal with that previously recorded material. So,
can I ask you a question?
Yes.
At first, excuse me because my English is not very well. But I could note that you make a difference, you take as a different parameter, the past and the present. And maybe it's just a coincidence, but you use the present to do something that you have total control, and you use the past to as something that you can control because it's already recorded and you didn't record it. And so you use a figurative and human figure to represent the past, but the present is abstract. There is something, it's just a coincidence in this to work, so there's something that have some meaning in your work.
I will try to answer because this is a very specific question, an interesting one. I'm progressively trying to let my expression going by itself, less controlling things. So, of course, I still want to control things, but for instance, using another, in that process, it was very difficult for me because at some point I wanted to change everything coming from the past, like these visuals. But in the process, it was like I wanted to challenge that in me, and I wanted to not to change completely the portrait. So basically it was like, I want to alter that, but I have to make this matter not completely abstract. So I wanted to keep it like figurative. It was like a deal with me, you know, with myself, I mean. And I don't know if I answer correctly because it is a bit difficult in English to talk about this kind of personal stuff, but I think now I'm trying to inject this kind of outside, like things more figurative, less abstract. And for me, it is very important because it is like using the reality. And my system is now not really closed. And I think I want to inject the world inside of it. So maybe I'm working now on another project, which is a live performance. And I have a lot of questions because I want to represent some kind of impossible architectures. And I don't know because I will use some real video, some real photography made from specific buildings. But I'm really like, again, in that process, I'd like to have the global control. So using a video for me means, yeah, but I want to have not only one side of the building, I want to have all sides. Yeah, first thing. Then I want to be able to maybe rotate on the building. And every time I have this idea of controlling things, so this is every time challenging for me to try to inject the reality because I think I want to change it every time. And maybe this is something dealing with my own frustration, I don't know, but I want, yeah, this is why I'm going to think this, because I want to maybe, yeah, okay, I want this building, I want to be able to rotate this building in any ways and exactly as I want. So I'm constantly moving from this kind of pure synthesis and just grabbing the reality as it is. So I don't know if I answered, but basically, I mean that this is something again in progress in me, and I had I had a nice coincidence because I have been contacted by mathematicians from a university in France just this week for working with their students, and they were telling me, yeah, if you want to make a residence with us, it could be interesting, maybe we can help you know about your visual stuff. And this is exactly absolutely challenging because I know these guys could provide a lot of tools for me for just creating these kind of architectures, but from scratch. And for me, it is tempting because it is kind of, again, controlling things. But I'd really like to, I think I will use these kind of tools, but for altering real pictures, I don't know. Maybe I'm a bit confused about that because for me, it is every time in process, you know, so. But yeah, I jumped over a specific page, which is named like that, because I just wanted maybe to talk about this stuff. I don't know about the time, if we are in time or...
Yes, we are.
Okay. So I read a lot about ontological stuff, and basically for me it is like injecting the past in the present. And I think I'm like in kind of this famous infinite loops Mark Fisher's talked about in some books. And it is like trying to finally to, at some point I wanted to change everything. I wanted to just use the computer for creating my own reality. It was like a utopic way. And now I'm more, maybe because I'm just aging, you know, but I'm more in a way of changing what is it, changing the reality which is already existing, just processing that and making maybe a different reality for me, but using the one which is already existing. And this is why I started to use a lot of tools for sound stuff, like granular synthesis. So I'm using a kind of, I'm using already recorded sounds and injecting that in my systems, which are hardware or software. And I'm using that as a raw matter for creating new sounds. So this is like, it is like taking something existing, deconstructing completely this for creating a new sound. And for me, it makes sense because it is really, something matching with my own, I would say, way of life now. It is not like erasing everything every time and rebuilding everything from scratch, but more like using I'm sorry, I lose my word, but it is like taking the reality as it is and try to change it, but by using the real matter at some point, not only from equation. Maybe I'm going from a kind of utopic ways into a more, not realistic, but because it is darker than that. Maybe it is more like dystopic stuff, you know. And this is why I started to use a lot of field recordings in my work. So I did a new installation. I presented that in Mira Festival in Barcelona 1 week ago. And this is really a mix of my both ways between pure synthesis, but also synthesis altered by real sound or previously recorded. So I think it is now shaping my almost all my work, using a kind of process for altering different realities. And yeah, so I don't know if some of you have some specific questions. I can answer that. Maybe I can also show you some other projects. So, yes.
I have a silly question.
Yeah, please, silly question.
A silly question, but not complicated. Why you don't use color?
Yeah, okay. So I think for me, color is like distracting. Yeah, it's like a distraction. I mean, it is distracting the eye from the light itself. I did a lot of. I was like a photographer, not publishing anything. Actually, I made some exhibitions, but it was like not really assumed. But I was a photographer for 10 years, and I was using only black and white, sometimes kind of colored Polaroid, but it was only for just capturing light itself. So I was more interested in the light itself and the intensity of the light than in by colors themselves. I think it is a bit like by using color, I wanted to try to create some kind of harmony by using color. And in my sound work, I think harmony is coming sometimes, but basically it is like an accident, you know. And I'm more interested in frequencies than by pure notes and scales and stuff like that. And I think it is the same with my visuals. So I can make a kind of comparison between both modality. And for my visual, I think color are meaningless. I mean, because for me, the light is enough for creating kind of structures. So colors would be like just changing the structures and maybe blurring the structures. So maybe I absolutely didn't answer, but this is my answer, actually. Yes, maybe I can show you another project. Can be interesting because it is on that point too. And actually the name is quite kind of interesting because the name is Matter. We did that with a friend, which is named here, is Sébastien Sati. And he's also living in Marseille, in the city where I'm living now. And we decided to create a project based on pre-recorded stuff. So he did a lot of videos, very do-it-yourself kind of videos, using macro photography of a small box filled by water and kind of powder inside, and made a lot of movement inside of this. So he did a lot of video like that. And I recorded a lot of sounds coming from kind of, I used woods, I was breaking. I did a lot of recording using microphone contact microphone. So everything was like pre-recorded and coming from a physical world. And we decided to connect our both systems. Basically, I designed also his system for playing his video. And maybe it is the first work in which I used not only synthesis, but also real and physical world with physical sounds. I mean, maybe I can show you some pictures, but we had a system. Yeah, we played it only one time, but this is just in standby. We will come back with that. Thank you. So this project is interesting because each one of our system were like independent but connected on a way by the sound. And each system was influencing the system of the other. And basically it was also each one of us was controlling his own stuff, but without knowing how the other would influence it. So it was like using sound. I was watching the screen, feeling something. Yeah, maybe I should use darker sound in the frequency spectrum wise. But at some point when he was changing the video playing, his system was sending a kind of pulse to my system, and my system was changing completely. And but I didn't exactly know when it would have done that. And my own system also, when I was playing with that, it was based on a modular Eurorack modular system, which is only hardware but with some parts which are digital. And my system was using some kind of loops, playing a sound, restarting it, and at the end of the loop it was sending a pulse into his system. And maybe the video was changing at this moment. So it was like trying to control a system that was both that was existing by itself, but in a way that we didn't really know how it would have been changed, and we lost some kind of control in the performance. It was interesting because I used to say that we were not two on stage but three. There was a kind that was that system made a bit with our ideas, but this system was like existing by itself, you know. And this work is very important for me because it is the first assumed work that uses only previously recorded sound and visuals. So yeah, I don't know if you have a question about this or anything else.
I found this work very beautiful.
You matter?
Yeah, I like it very much. ¿Alguien tiene una pregunta? Si quieren hacerla en español, puedo hacer mi mejor intento de traducírselas fidedignamente.
Yo quería hacer una pregunta de algo.
Sí. ¿Este micrófono?
Hi. I wanted to ask you about the sound analysis. You mentioned that you do, for example, take into account the volume of the sound and the mean frequency in the spectrum. Which other analysis do you do to extract some sense from the sound? Because what I found that if you just use the volume or the frequencies or a spectrum analysis, you extract variables that are very irregular in time. And I'm trying to find a way to extract some sense from the music or from the sound, and I find it very difficult by just measuring the level of frequency or the volume. Which tools you use or which process you use to try to grab some sense from the sound that the system is catching.
Yeah, this is a very interesting question because I think I absolutely don't do that. By saying sense, you mean kind of not only quantities but qualities, I think, in the sense of maybe a sound can be harmonic or disharmonic, things like that. Or maybe I think this is on higher level. What
yes,
you are
like if you're listening to a song, there are moments where things are, you know, you can add some feeling to the sound. This moment is happy. This moment is dark. This moment is intense. This moment is, I don't know, it's some way. In some way, it's like putting some human adjectives or emotion to each part of the sound that is. A high-level concept is not a variable you can measure in the sound. Is more human concept.
Yeah, I think at least at the lab, where the Laboratoire de Mécanique et d'Acoustique, they are studying that, but more on a perception way. They were trying to kind to make some characterization of sound territories. There were a study, I read a paper from them, related to I think it was, they were working with schizophrenic people, and they were very interested by how they can perceive usual sounds. So they created a kind of, with Max MSP again, the same software I'm using for creating my art, you know. But they are using that for creating specific sounds and trying to create a kind of map with different territories, like strange sounds, frightening sounds, like relaxing sounds. And they were using that with a lot of people, and they tried to find some kind of, it is named in French, invariant, like constant stuff. So they could characterize specific sounds that are relaxing for a majority of people, you know. And they were using that with different kind of people. Some were like schizophrenic or autistic people. And it was really interesting because some spaces of some sound territories were very different. And I think for using that, they were using harmony and disharmony and like distortion and stuff like that. But in my work, I don't use that because basically I'm only using these values, which are very less and poor, I would say, compared to what you are saying about we can have a moment of intense, I don't know, happiness in the music. But this is because I don't really need that, because basically I keep a part of controlling my sound, so I know that this part will be dark for me. But I don't want the computer to know about that, basically. But this is a very interesting question because it could trigger more question in my mind too. And so this is why I'm using only values like that, but sometimes a lot of values, not only the volume and spectral frequency stuff, because we can also calculate, for instance, some other parameters related to sound, but very related to the physics of the sound, basically. Not sometimes also about how we perceive the sounds. So there are specific scales of sound relative to how our ears perceive the sound. So this is not only physics, this is also psychoacoustic, but not in the sense of I want to use all these parameters for making my computer know it is a happy moment or dark moment. I don't know if I answer, but basically I'm only using all these values which are already really enough for altering the shapes. So okay. Maybe just for conclude on this question, the link between all these values and what I can call a dark moment or more intense moment, maybe this link is just me playing with the computer. So in my case, which is absolutely not a scientific research case, in this case, I don't need that basically. No. But it is very interesting. Maybe you read some papers about that, because there are a lot of papers written about how we can perceive and analyze music in more sense-wise, as you said.
Maybe come tomorrow, yes. For experiencing fragments. Maybe we can also discuss after the performance.
Yeah, I'd be really happy if you can come to the museum just for the performance tomorrow, because I think it can also illustrate what I tried to explain today. And maybe we can also have a discussion after the performance if you are interested. Maybe I didn't want today to present some very technical stuff. But if you are interested in that and what is, I would say, the science underlying, we can also discuss about that, maybe just now, later, or maybe tomorrow if you are interested. So I'm in the city until Monday, so if you want to have a coffee and discuss about dark techniques relative to MaxMXP only, we can do that. Okay. Well, thank you very much for your listening.